Margate, a town of 61,000 souls on the Kent coast, is this year hosting the Turner Prize. Four nominees will battle it out for the highest honour in the British art world. Local girl made good Tracey Emin will be guest of honour at the opening ceremony, taking place at the shiny new Turner Contemporary Gallery.
Are you waiting to go in?
Want to buy that box that you got in the window there for £6?
I'll wait and sort that for you. I won't be a minute.
I've got the right money.
Good man.
What is it? It's a sewing box, is it? Or...
What do you want it to be?
No, it's just go on my shelf.
Well, that's just a little thing you put your knickknacks in. Stuff. I've got a box like this, I put all my special bits of paper in.
Yeah, it's all sort of old scootery stuff, because I'm an old mod, you know.
Aren't we all? That's it. Mainly what we're doing is buying stuff that some people don't want, trying to find somebody else who does want it. Come on. Come on. Quite a green business, really. Wow. Good show. Another load of treasure. Cool. When I first got here, I was amazed. I hadn't been to Margate, apart from one of the boys' day out, until my parents bought a guest house in Union Crescent just down the road. And when I got to Margate, about 11 o'clock on a Sunday morning, I rolled the shutters of this truck up and I jumped out in the middle of the street, great big wide street, and I was gobsmacked by the silence, because I come from South London, and there was nothing. No traffic, no noise, no nothing at all. And I thought, oh, God, what have I done here? Because I was 17 and up for it, you know? And it looked like I'd gone to the back of nowhere. I love it. All my family live here. Most of my family work with me. Absolutely lovely. The whole town is buzzing. Everybody's friendly and it's relaxed and it's laid back. It's not like London at all. Mind you, there's loads of DFLs here, so that makes it a bit like London. Some people think they're in Bermondsey. DFLs is a term that the local people use for down from London.
The old ones around here.
Since the Turner arrived, things have just been getting gradually better and better and better and better, and the town now is just floating along on a buzz. It's really good. We've got some beautiful architecture and big old Victorian Edwardian properties. And now people are coming down buying these great big houses and turning them into family homes. It's wonderful. Over there in the Petman's Depository upstairs, they've got resort studios. That's a whole floor taken over with little units doing different crafts and things. We've got loads of really nice, trendy sort of coffee bars and good places to eat. Everything's changed, everything. All for the better. I can't see a downside to it, apart from the fact that my kids and my grandchildren are coming along. They're going to find it hard to get onto the property ladder because the price of property is going up, obviously. But it's still way behind London and all the rest.
My name is Tai Shani. I'm an artist and I'm nominated for the Turner Prize this year. I'm untrained, so I'm self-taught, which is quite, I think, unusual in the art world today. I've been working on an experimental adaptation of a 1405 book called The Book of the City of Ladies. This was an allegorical idea that I was interested in, so I decided to try and build a post-patriarchal city. I wanted to have something that was floating above this more rational structure. And it began, you know, as a feminist project, and now I call it a post-patriarchal project, and I want it to be this incredibly inclusive space. There's such a codification around how we understand art that it is often almost impenetrable. Art still sees itself as this completely revolutionary agent, but a lot of the more revolutionary moments are happening within like a much broader popular culture than the rarefied spaces of visual contemporary art. So, you know, like Beyoncé referencing the Black Panthers at the Super Bowl is a much bigger moment and a much more kind of meaningful moment to many more people than my project around feminism. So I think it's important for art to happen everywhere and for people to have access to it and for art to be accessible in the way it's coded and in the way it's kind of presented to people. So I'm very happy for this project to happen here and to, you know, I'm excited to see what the response will be, really.
I think when I was younger, I always wanted to get out of the area. I hated it. And then when you go away and come back, you actually appreciate what you've got. So I took over when I was 19, thinking I could make loads of money and go travelling. That didn't quite work out to plan. Eventually got there. I think we've got like a really good reputation now. I'm kind of proud of it, I suppose.
We love Dolby, don't we? Yeah. Cliftonville is the worst bit around here.
Yeah, I mean, there's some really nice places in Margate, really beautiful, but then there's some real dives.
But you have noticed that they are trying to build it back up, aren't they?
Yeah.
You can see, like, the Turner Centre's been quite good for the seafront and that as well, hasn't it? Maybe might restore Margate a bit. And to be honest, I haven't been there either. I did see two ladies the other day asking me for directions for it, and I've read about quite a bit about it. It's meant to be really good, so it's obviously doing well. Yeah. It's like that little indoor market in Margate, isn't it? We haven't been in there, but we'll drive past all the time and we'll be like, oh, yeah, we should go in there. When the kids are at school next week, we'll pop in there. And then we just don't.
Yeah.
The idea behind Turner Contemporary was to celebrate JMW Turner's links with Margate. And Turner stayed with Mrs. Booth in a boarding house on this very site. So that the views that we get out of the gallery windows are the views that Turner would have known and loved. In his day, Turner was radical, he was pioneering. His work was not understood at all. The Turner Prize coming to Margate and to Turner Contemporary is a massive deal. In those early years, there were lots of people who were sceptical, and I think there was a huge amount of work to change people's mindsets, to get people on board. Often, I think regeneration is talked in terms of shiny new buildings, and here we have a great example of a brilliant new building. But actually, it's about people who bring those buildings to life. Today, opening Turner Prize, there's been a real excitement, a sense that the arts can make real change.
Turner Centre's brought the people in, but it hasn't really hit other parts of Margate, so Cliftonville's still struggling, the top end of the high streets are still struggling. So it's not quite had the effect that we'd like it to have at this moment.
Yeah, we went once when it first opened and it was just a load of stuff that didn't really make sense to me. I'm Ray, I've been running this pub for 4 years. I've been in the trade for 30 years now. I'm actually a pensioner, but I'm still doing it. We came here when it was doing nothing, really, and changed it into what we enjoy and we love, which is the music and the people. Entertainment-wise, we got the best DJs in town doing the ska, reggae, mod. The banter's always good, you know. Back in the 70s, Margate was absolutely fantastic. You couldn't walk down the streets, it was that busy. I don't think it'll ever come back to that, but it's certainly getting busier since the Turner's been there. Pete's Fish and Chip Shop does really well out of it. He's a millionaire now. Turner used to drink in this pub back in the day. Apparently he stayed here as well. There used to be 5 letting rooms upstairs years and years ago. So yeah, what with that and the sunset, people do come to the pub because they know about the pub from Turner.
Turner first came to Margate in 1788 when he was 13 years old. He came here to go to school and to escape illness at home. His mother suffered from some form of mental illness, and this was probably the first time he'd ever experienced the sea in all its different views and moods, and really sets the tone for much of his later interests as an artist. Turner then returns to Margate pretty much throughout his life, but particularly this crystallises around the 1830s and 1840s when he begins to make use of the steamer service directly from London. And here he found lodgings pretty much on the spot where we're standing right now, the present-day Turner Contemporary building, a lodging house run by a lady called Mrs. Sophia Booth. And she then proved to be an added incentive to keep on returning to the town. They lived together, to all intents and purposes, as man and wife, although Turner would have kept this relationship secretive from his artistic colleagues. even during the 19th century, Margate had a reputation as something of a kiss-me-quick seaside town. It was known for its health benefits, but it also had this whiff of a place for perhaps illicit romantic liaisons. But Turner himself is a working-class Londoner. His father is a barber and a wig maker. He's born in Covent Garden. So I think for someone who drops his H's and likes to watch his pennies, Margate really is a perfect holiday destination for him.
It sort of still feels a bit unbelievable to me to be nominated for the Turner Prize. I feel incredibly privileged. It's the most prestigious art prize in the UK. It's exciting and it's scary. It's all of those things rolled into one. But I think the other thing for me is that it's a bigger platform, I suppose. There are more people who will see the work that I make, and it's not just about the numbers, it's about the kinds of people that will get to see the work. For this show, I have a film called The Long Note, which is a film about the role and position and place of women in the civil rights movement in Northern Ireland from 1968, which was the beginning, the first of the civil rights marches, and then it kind of goes through into the 70s and Bloody Sunday. So it's looking at how women's position has been viewed throughout the Troubles in Northern Ireland.
It's the armed forces of the state who recognise the power of women.
The structural thread is the interview that I did with Bernadette Devlin McAliskey. And one of the things that she and I started to talk about was the relationship between the civil rights movement in Northern Ireland and the one in the States. She, I guess, probably was the female face of the civil rights movement, and certainly she was an incredibly young MP in the House of Commons. And she inspired not just women, but she inspired all the different kinds of communities to think about what it meant to stand up for what you believe in, but also what you believe you have the right to. I want to stimulate dialogue. I want that to be part of what happens. So the idea of having this research table gives a context to, I suppose, to what I've been thinking about when I made the film, but also for them to have conversations or just to sit and think and reflect, really.
T.S. Eliot, suffering from nervous exhaustion, came to Margate to convalesce.
My feet are at Margate, and my heart under my feet. After the event, he wept. He promised a new start. I made no comment. What should I resent? On Margate Sands, I can connect nothing with nothing. The broken fingernails of dirty hands. My people, humble people who expect nothing. La la.
Well, we got married in Dungeness and we stopped off here and stayed the night at the Nail and Rock. So that was about 12, 13 years ago. But a lot was boarded up along the seafront, showing no signs of like opening and stuff. We had a miscarriage and for some reason, we came down here for the weekend. And within what felt like a week, we bought a house. There's always a moment in death where you have this extreme clarity of what's important and what's not. I just wanted to be like part of a town, and having a shop seemed like the best way, really. You could leave London and just open a shop, and if you got it right, then you might just make enough money to be able to feed yourself and your family. And it's a coastal town, and our biggest asset is the beaches and the water, so I figured if I could cultivate something that celebrated that, then I wouldn't be stepping on anyone else's toes economically. And there wasn't a seaweed shop. I always like the fact that everyone's like, you know, where does the seaweed come from? And then you can just sort of point across the street. It's just made it so much easier. No one's using it, you know, people used to. But no one's using it now. We've got members of staff who are getting married and thinking about families and stuff, and they would have had a a career in their hometown, and that to me is really important.
People are scared that it's going to become over-gentrified with its new life, but it can't. Margate just doesn't have that kind of... The energy is much harder, much, much more warm. Something kind of slightly crazy, something quite sexy about Margate as well. And I like that. I like the rawness of it. Margate is known as the last resort. It's like right at the end of England. It's right at the knuckle of Britain. And there's nowhere to go. I think the main reason why I've come back to Margate is because my mum died. And when my mum was dying, I realised I just didn't like the idea of not being able to come here or not have a reason to come here. But when I grew up here, it wasn't in the doldrums. It was still very exciting. And bank holidays and during the summer, really cool people come down here to visit and everything. There were really good clubs like Atlantis and places to dance. And it was really trendy and hip. And it was cutting edge of fashion as well. And Margate hadn't been boarded up for 10 years. You know, still going strong from like the 50s or whatever.
Over in Cliftonville, each of these bathing beauties hopes to win a contest for the neatest figure. Before the judging, every girl puts on a mask to prevent a pretty face influencing the final decision.
I've been coming here since 53, on and off. I like paintings. I like good paintings. A good race horse or a good country picture or something like that. Yeah, that's me.
There's loads of things that have come off the back of the Turner Centre. Believe it or not, people didn't want it. Stupidly, they used to say they want an ice rink and all the rest of it. Well, it's either going to be here or Folkestone or something like that. And 20 million or whatever it was coming into the area. It's attracted a certain type of person from London. Hands down, it's made a huge difference.
Ruined our breakfast, mate. I'm enjoying my sausage. Well enjoying
Hang
my sausage
on a minute.
As well.
I told you that you could finish it. In short, the chat in the back of the car, it's been alleged that he's assaulted somebody. Okay. So he's got to come back to the police station and be spoken to about it. We love Margate. It's great. Vibrant, busy.
Up and coming.
Up and coming.
There is a revival in Margate, without a shadow of a doubt. Money spent, people coming from out of town and spending money, which is good to see.
Shit off. No offence, don't know if we can say that, but it needs looking after. They're making us do stuff now just because that lady's coming down. Like, why can't they look after it? Why can't they look after it all the time? They're making all the council clean all the sides, and they're making us go all out for it, they're making all the community service people clean all the Turner Centre plates and that. Why can't they look after it when this lady isn't coming down? Like, people live here, this is a town, this is someone's, this is people's houses, home.
We can call you on your NPR.
She's doing it now.
Everybody's clearing up everything and making it all look nice, but they're only making that look nice because that thing's going on down the Turner Centre. They don't normally look after it, that's all. And I'm not just saying that because obviously he's just been arrested. Cliftonville is really, really bad.
My name is Oscar Murillo, and I am a contemporary artist. This space where we are now and where my installation is became very attractive. I found the window, this vista, as a marker or as an anchor to begin a conversation. The Effigies is a body of work that has had different iterations. They come from folkloric culture, and it's about the idea of the spirits and almost a shield against, you know, bad spirits. I started to bring them into the realm of my practice because there is a kind of energy and spirituality that I believe in. And then I began to think about human capital and human resource, and therefore, you know, the idea of presenting them or them presenting themselves in front of an audience and vice versa. I see them as having this non-culture-specific notion of the working class that is tremendously universal.
Open School East is, I guess, what people would call an alternative art school. We deliver about 100 workshops and talks and performances a year, all free to the community.
That's it.
My name's Ayaan. I'm in charge of one of the programs called Despacito. We have between 15 to 20 children every Wednesday, 4 o'clock until 6. We literally have to go knock on their doors, wait for them to get out of the school uniform, run up, greet them. Then we go to the next house and we kind of look like the Pied Piper with a bunch of children. I guess people would describe them as working class, so on and so forth, but to me, they're just young children.
My name's Aaron. I'm your dude, innit?
But here, they get to be artists.
It's called Despacito.
People come and they think it's a song, but it's not, because it's art.
We're doing hair printing stuff and doing badges.
It's about creating opportunities for them that they won't get elsewhere. The issues here are real and deep.
He's finished doing that side and your side.
And as much as I talk about art, I also realise we have a bigger duty to help them expand their worldview. Don't mess with it, don't mess with it.
And so, what you did, you worked with lots of different people. You made this archive, or you looked at this thing called a folk archive to document this bit of history.
Because Turner Contemporary is here, it has unleashed a massive wave of people moving to Margate that are artists and setting up other spaces. At this point in time, in terms of regeneration, I think we're more repopulating the space. I think at some point we will start to push out people, and when the landlords decide they can raise the rent, all those people will be kicked out. Well, where are they going to go? Where do you go? Margate is the poorest area around, so what's the next stop?
Everybody say thank you, Justin!
What is that name?
Oh, that's so cool!
My goal with Despacito is to get them enthused about art, let them finish education, then come back to us. I would love for at least 2, 4, 5, 6, 10 of them to become artists in the future. That'd be amazing.
Look, the staircase is going nowhere. Wow.
We're standing in Margate Caves on North Down Road. I've known these caves since I was about 6 years old, I think was the first time I came here. And I'm so pleased because this year they've just been reopened again after years and years of being closed. When we were little, it was kind of like a fearful place, you know, it was kind of like living inside some kind of wild pirate's cave or something. Child again, really, coming here, and I think everybody does when they enter here. It's so good to see people go, wow, and it really is something unexpected. No one believes how amazing they're going to be.
My name is Lawrence Abu Hamdan. I'm an artist. I live in Beirut. I call myself a private ear. That means a kind of private investigator of sound. I'm showing 3 works this year in the Turner Prize exhibition. One is a silent lightbox piece. One is a film. And the other is a 6-channel sound piece with animated text. In 2016, I was part of an investigation for Amnesty International, constructing ear witness interviews on the prison Saidnaya, which is 25 kilometers north of Damascus. The prisoners themselves never really saw the prison. They entered blindfolded. They spent the majority of the time in one cell. So to get any information out about what was going on inside really demanded a kind of unlocking of their acoustic memories, because sound was so much part of their experience. Silence was brutally enforced there, which paradoxically crystallized any sound that did happen in that space. So there's no speech. Speech was punishable by death.
I no longer know what there is behind the wall. I no longer know there is a wall. I no longer know this wall is a wall. I no longer know what a wall is.
These things were vital for a human rights perspective to understand, because the silence itself was criminal in that prison.
بتعطي نوع من الإرهاب يعني للسجناء وبتعطي صدى يعني بحيث ما ببين الضرب وين.
And somehow what I intend is not only that you see the disappearance of the voice, but somehow it stand in for the voice of the disappeared.
Crusade for Freedom, Empire State Building, New York City. Or join in your local community.
Officially open Turner Prize 2019.
Oh, really exciting. I don't know much about the Turner Prize. I'm a great fan of Turner, great fan of the Turner Centre. Obviously, it's going to bring so many people here. Can't be anything but good for the town.
It's brilliant for the town, it's absolutely fantastic, and it's brought so many people into it, and long may it continue. But I won't go there, it's not art. Turner will be turning in his grave.
You want to go and have a look at my bedroom then? It's got it's got fag butts and all sorts all around it.
That's art, on that wall.
Good looking dude, isn't it, eh?